Today on Race Car Engineering, sorry. They have build up. Today on Race Cars Explained, we're gonna be talking all about suspension. Suspension in your street cars, suspension on race cars, and how it all works. And we're gonna explain the different suspension components, what they do, and some different things with alignments and toe, camber, caster, what all of these different measurements are and how they affect the vehicle. Let's get started. So the first thing we're gonna talk about is alignment and how critical that is. So let's start with camber. It is the most popular and probably the most well understood. So if we look at this tire, the camber is basically the lean of the tire. So it's showing how much the wheel is leaned over to compensate for tire deflection. On a street car, we typically see a little bit of negative camber. Negative camber, I mean, is the outside portion of the wheel is leaned in. So the top of the wheel is leaned in towards the car. On a street car, you'll see 1, maybe 2 degrees max. On a race car, you'll see up to about 5 degrees. The reason for this is what happens is when the tire is loaded up and the car is going around a corner, that tire contact patch basically distorts to the road. If we lean the wheel like this, when the car is at full cornering force and the tire is distorted, the contact patch is sitting flat against the ground, giving the car the best handling and the most cornering force. On a race car, you typically have camber plates up at the top or adjustable control arms as these TCRs have down on the bottom. That gives us about 5 to 6, even sometimes 7 degrees of adjustability in the camber. On a street car, you'll usually find eccentric bolts. What that is that's a bolt that is off-centered a little bit. And as that bolt rotates, the camber gains and detracts. On a street car, you're only usually gonna see about maybe 1/2 to 2 degrees of camber adjustment available. So the next one we're gonna talk about is one of my favorites, and that is toe. Toe is super, super critical in racing and is really what allows the car to turn quickly and get around the corners as fast as possible. All cars have toe. So you may think that your tires are pointed perfectly straight when you're going down the road, but that's actually not true. So on a street car, what usually is found in the front is toe in. Toe in settles the car and it makes it go straight on the road. If you let go of the steering wheel and you hit a bump, it doesn't want to dart all over the place. On a race car, we usually have toe out. That makes for a very unstable car, but it also makes for a car that turns in much better and can be much more aggressively used on track. So as an example of this, imagine this is the outside of the wheel. This is the car right here. Toe in would be pointing the wheel in towards itself, and the other wheel would be pointing in toward itself as well. This would constantly be pushing the car inward, and you can imagine that creates a very stable atmosphere. Now on a race car, we typically toe out. That means the wheels are pointed outward, and the other wheel is pointed outward. That means the two wheels are constantly fighting each other, trying to pull the car outwards. What happens is if one wheel gets more traction than the other, the car tends to dart in those directions. It makes it for less stability, but a faster car in general. So toe is actually one of the easiest things to adjust on all cars. And actually the adjustment methods on a race car are exactly the same as your street car. So the toe adjustment is made by the tie rod length. So extending the tie rod length, if the steering rack is found behind the axle, will actually create toe in. Shortening the tie rod length will actually create toe out. The only real difference you'll find on the tie rods on a race car versus the tie rods on a street car, or the tie rods on a street car actually have a little S curve in them typically. This is a manufactured failure point. The reason for this is if you get in a car accident or your wheel hits something hard, the steering wheel will actually not move at the force because of this little failure point. It will keep people from breaking their wrists. On a race car, we don't want that failure point. So we actually just are trained to let go of the steering wheel in a bad accident. All right, the next thing we're gonna talk about is caster. Caster is actually the lean of the McPherson strut on the front of this car. So if we had a car with zero caster, it would mean the strut would be pointed perfectly straight up and down or perfectly at 12 o'clock. Now, as we add caster, we actually lean that strut further back, and that's going to add for camber gain and self-centering. So let me show you how this actually works by turning the steering wheel. So we look at the front wheel, you can see that it's pretty much straight up and down, but as I turn the front wheel, you can see the wheel starts to lean into the angle that I'm turning it. It's leaning into the corner. Now that's gonna help out with that contact patch that we talked about and how important that is for making the car handle. Now if I straighten it back out, you can see that the wheel is now becoming straight again. So all of that camber gain that you saw as the wheel leaned over and then straightened back up is because of the amount of caster that's put in this car. Now this being a race car with race car geometry has a significant amount more caster than a standard street car. So one of the big things that caster adds, as you've seen, is it adds camber gain. The other thing it does is it self-centers. So the further back the strut is, the more self-centering this has. So you might see drift cars when they turn in and they start sliding and they literally just let go of the steering wheel. The reason that happens is because they have a lot of caster built into their front suspension and it actually points the tires in the direction the car is traveling. Only negative thing you really have with adding a lot of caster is what it does is it makes the tire and the suspension very susceptible to hitting bumps in the road. So if you have a lot of caster in the car and you've hit a bump, what it's going to do is that self-centering is going to act in reverse and it's basically going to rip the steering wheel out of your hand. So it makes the car a little more challenging to drive, but in general for performance applications, it's much better. Let's talk a little bit about what actually lifts the car up off the ground, and that is the spring. The spring is the device that gives a mechanical lift to the car. So if we didn't have springs in the cars, all cars are basically sitting on the ground. So the car's weight sits on all four corners on these springs. This spring right here is a Sachs Performance Mark 7 GTI spring. This is a street spring. You can see it has a sort of odd shape to it. It's what we call a barrel spring, so it gets bigger and smaller. It's also progressive. The way I can tell it's progressive is you can see that these coils are closer to each other, these coils are further away. What a progressive spring rate means is that the spring rate is not linear. It actually gets stiffer the more I squeeze the spring. Now comparing that to a race car, right here, we have an Eibach race spring. This is one of the springs we actually use right in this car. So if I take this out of the box, you'll see this is much smaller than a streetcar spring. It actually fits inside of it. This is also much stiffer. So if you look at the wire diameter, the thickness of this wire, you can see how much thicker it is than this. This is because this is a much higher spring rate. So in a race car, we're not concerned about ride comfort and being smooth over speed bumps and bumpy roads. We're looking all for speed. So in order to keep the chassis stiff, we run really high spring rates. You can also see that this is not a progressive spring. This is a linear spring. This means that this spring is going to have the same rate whether I squeeze it this much or I squeeze it down to here. Now that we've talked about springs, let's look at the springs on the car. So you can see right here, the spring is mounted on this threaded collar. This threaded collar allows for ride height adjustment. So on race cars, we can actually adjust the ride height and we can also adjust the weight balance using these threaded collars. So if we just had springs in the car would basically bounce right down the road, like one of those toys you see at a playscape. So what is added is a damper. And this damper is from this race car. This one is from a street car. To control the energy of the spring, what a damper has is oil inside of it and a piston that has to travel through that oil. It requires energy to travel through that oil, so it actually controls the spring movement. So basically, if you had a screen door and you open it up and it has one of those little gas pressure things on the bottom and it slowly closes, that's exactly what's going on in this damper. It's basically controlling the energy of the spring. That said, obviously the weight of the car and the spring rates involved are much higher energy than the door on your house. Now that we understand what dampers do, let's look at the difference between these two dampers. So this one right here is a race car damper. So you can see it's threaded, so ride height adjustment for the spring being perched on it. It is also a gas monotube, which means it's a singular tube. You can see, you can always tell a gas monotube because the chrome section that goes inside the strut is much larger. Now this also is a gas pressurized damper, which means that there's a gas pressure behind the oil and that keeps the oil from aerating. What happens is as that piston travels through very quickly, air bubbles form and the damper becomes less effective. Now, the last thing you're gonna notice about a race car damper is that it's actually adjustable. So you can see right here on the bottom, there's two adjustments. One for compression, when this thing shortens up as you hit a bump, or rebound, one as it gets longer as you're coming off of the bump. We use that as a tool in the race cars to adjust the suspension for different track settings and different weather conditions to get the most out of the car. So now let's talk about the Sachs Performance Streetcar Damper. So you can see, by principle, it's pretty much the same as the race car part. It mounts at the top, we have the chrome part that actually goes inside this damper. There's oil inside it. So there's two noticeable differences. First, this is a twin tube damper. This is not a monotube. You can tell by how much thinner this top section is. The other thing is that this has no adjustability for ride height. So you can see that the spring perch, which is much bigger to handle this much larger spring, is fixed to the damper, which means we can't adjust the ride height and go up and down with the car. Now the last thing you're gonna notice is that it doesn't have any adjustability for the dampening. So the dampening ratios in this damper are fixed to this component and can never be altered. So now that we've discussed dampers and springs, let's look at how they fit on this race car. So you can actually see right here is the strut. This is the basic damper on the front of the car. You can also see the spring and the adjustable coils to allow this to go up and down. Let's talk about the rest of the suspension geometry and how critical that is to the way this car handles. So we've talked about camber, we've talked about caster, and we've talked about toe, and how critical they are to getting the most out of this tire on the racetrack. That said, if we want to really get the most out of that tire, we actually need to make sure the suspension doesn't deflect. This is your standard GTI control arm. It has a big rubber bushing right here at one end and a bigger rubber bushing right here at the other end. What that does is it eliminates noise from the road coming into the chassis of the car. So that makes it quieter, makes it more comfortable to drive, and it makes it easier for everyday use. But what that also does is when the suspension is loaded up in a high stress environment, what it would see on a racetrack, these bushings deflect. And what will happen is you may dial in 4 degrees of negative camber. As that bushing deflects, that camber will typically decrease and you'll actually get less performance from the car. So right here, we have the control arm from the race car. So you'll see that this has some different characteristics to it. First, it's a little bit stronger and a little bit lighter, but the main thing we're talking about is those bushings deflecting. And to combat that, this has these silver spherical bearings, or what is called Heim joints, on them. What that is it's a joint that is metal to metal contact that allows for the pivot that's required for the suspension to move, but it doesn't allow any movement in any other direction. The positive to this is when the suspension is pushed in any sort of force from turning or braking, these do not deflect at all. They locate the suspension in the exact same location. All right, so we've talked about the suspension mostly on one corner of the car. One thing we need to talk about though is how the suspension on the left side of the car is actually connected to the suspension on the right side of the car. And that is through the sway bar, or otherwise known as the anti-roll bar. So let's pop the hood on this car and take a look at the actual anti-roll bar. We'll see that the sway bar is actually mounted in the standard location right on top of the subframe. The difference though on a race car sway bar is that is actually a hollow bar. You'll also notice that on the end of that hollow bar has these what we call blades. They're welded onto it and they have multiple holes. These multiple holes allow for adjustment very quickly on the same exact sway bar. So let's talk a little bit exactly what a sway bar does. So a sway bar literally links the right side control arm to the left side control arm on the car. So as the suspension on one side goes up, the suspension on the other side goes up. So this keeps the car from rolling over too much or swaying in the corners. What it does also is it is a bar, so it has a torsional spring to it. So imagine it isn't not a one-to-one link. It actually, the bar twists as force is applied. So the stiffer the bar, the less it allows it to twist. Now we're at the rear suspension, and really pretty much the same sort of differences apply. So right here, I actually have a standard Mark 7 GTI sway bar. And you see right here, you can see the two mounts for the chassis, one here and one here. And you can also see the two end link mounts right here and here that tie it into the rear suspension. The big difference you're gonna see here is it doesn't have a blade on it, and it is also completely solid steel. So on a race car, we actually have hollow sway bars. The reason for that is mostly to cut down on weight. So this is a lot of extra material that's used on a street car because it's easier to manufacture, but on a race car, we don't need that, and we want the car as light as possible. Now moving on to the suspension, you'll also notice is actually the damper on this rear. So you see this is actually upside down. The reason for that is it actually decreases what we call the unsprung weight. So the unsprung weight is everything that is not sprung on the car. Basically the wheel, the rotor, the brakes, the suspension components. This all moves with the suspension and we want to keep it as light as possible. The lighter these components are, the faster they can react to bumps and changes in the road. So to do that, you can see that this is actually has the heavy side with all the oil in it up top. That's actually mounted directly to the car. The lighter side with the bump stops and the smaller diameter rod is actually mounted to the suspension. Now looking at this, you can see the brakes on this are actually very small, standard GTI brakes. And then if you look at all of these suspension components compared to the streetcar, they all have spherical bearings on them, which means metal to metal contact and no bushing deflection. So to compare that to a streetcar, right here you can see this is the standard trailing arm on a Mark 7 Golf. You can see this has a big rubber bushing that can deflect very easily on it. On this race car, we have a spherical bearing right here. The other thing you're gonna notice is right here, on this upper camber link, you can see this has a rubber bushing on one side here and a rubber bushing on the other side here. On the race car, it has a spherical bearing here and a spherical bearing on the inside. The other big thing you're gonna notice on this is it actually has an adjustable section on it on the race car. This allows for greater camber adjustment, just like we talked about up front, on a race car versus a street car. All right, everyone, I really hope you enjoyed this episode of Race Cars Explained. I hope you learned a lot about suspension, suspension geometry, dampers, springs, and how all these components work together. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments below. And if you want to see more of this, don't forget to give us a thumbs up and subscribe. Thanks for watching.